The first part of verse 11 says, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it." That the large throne is white depicts divine holiness, purity, and righteousness. Psalm 97 says, "Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne." And the one who is seated appears to be Jesus, to whom all judgment is committed. In John 5, Jesus says, "For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son." And in Acts, Paul said, "God has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained," and that is Jesus. The last part of verse 11 says, "For from his face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them." This can be understood as the dissolution of the universe in preparation for the appearance of the new heaven and the new earth that we see in chapter 21. Peter wrote, "The heavens and the earth, which are now, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men." This judgment is depicted in the remainder of chapter 20. The first part of verse 12 says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God." These are the rest of the dead, as stated in verse 5, who did not rise in the first resurrection at the coming of Christ 1,000 years earlier. Paul said, "There will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust." And in this connection, Jesus spoke in Luke of people who having died will rise up in the judgment. In Hebrews 9, it says, "It is appointed for men to die once, and after this, the judgment." At his return, Jesus judged the living of the nations, and now he is about to judge the dead of all the nations. And this final judgment will concern all those who died without saving faith up to the return of Christ, and all mortals who died during his 1,000-year reign. Isaiah says at this time, "No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner, being 100 years old, shall be accursed." The last part of verse 12 says, "And books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books." Here we are told that the books that are opened contain the deeds of those being judged. As for the book of life mentioned here, we learn in chapter 3 that it contains the names of all those who have eternal life through Jesus Christ. The judging of the dead according to what they have done aligns with what Paul wrote in Romans of the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each one according to his deeds. And in Jeremiah 17, we read, "I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings." Verse 13 says, "The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works." Apparently, the sea gives up the dead who are in it when the earth is said to have fled away, as we saw in verse 11. And the sea is no more, as we shall see in chapter 21. And John speaks in the verse we're looking at about the release of the dead from imprisonment in Hades to be bodily resurrected in order to be judged. And Jesus plainly said in Matthew 10 that at this time, people will have both soul and body. The spirits of the dead will therefore be clothed in a body when they stand before the throne at the last judgment. Verse 14 says, "Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death." Both death, which separates body from spirit, and Hades, which is the abode of the disembodied spirits who are without Christ, are now destroyed. Paul wrote, "The last enemy that will be destroyed is death." Therefore, the next chapter in the Revelation says, "There shall be no more death." The phrase "the second death" implies there being a first death, which is what people experience when they die. Now we come to the very last verse in chapter 20, "And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Psalm 69 says to the wicked, "Let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not be written with the righteous." This tells us the names of the wicked will not be found written in the book of life. Now the book of life will be consulted at the last judgment appears to indicate that some people's names would be found written in this book at that time. Otherwise, there is no point in the book of life being opened, as we are told in verse 12. And the two outcomes of either life or the lake of fire can be seen in Romans, where Paul says, wrote of the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each one according to his deeds, eternal life to those who by patient endurance do in doing seek glory, honor, and immortality, but to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath. Now, that the wicked are cast into the lake of fire relates to what Jesus said in Matthew 18 about being cast into hellfire. And that this happens to the wicked after the resurrection can be seen in that Jesus spoke in Matthew 5 about the body and being cast into hell. Okay, so now we have come to the end of chapter 20. And next time, we'll look at chapter 21, which tells us about the eternal home of all the saved.